In today's Medico Apps Masterclass, we will learn about electron transport chain. Let's look at the role of electron transport chain in the overall metabolism of our body. Now we know that we have carbohydrates, protein and fats, which are broken down into glucose, amino acids and glycerol plus fatty acids. These three are eventually even broken down further into acetyl-CoA. The acetyl-CoA formed is then taken to the Krebs cycles or the TCA cycle, wherein it will form the carbon dioxide. Along with that, we have formation of NADH plus H and FADH2. Here, NAD and FAD are two carrier molecules which will take the hydrogen ion generated from the TCA cycle and then transfer it to the electron transport chain. So, once the acetyl-CoA is taken through the Krebs cycle or the TCA cycle, we have carbon dioxide and then we have hydrogen ions. These hydrogen ions are taken up by the carrier molecules. We have two carrier molecules, NAD and FAD, which are respectively converted into NADH plus H and FADH2. Now, these carrier molecules carry the hydrogen ion from the TCA or the Krebs cycle to the electron transport chain. Now, it is at this electron transport chain wherein these hydrogen ions along with oxygen are converted into water, as well as during the process energy or ATP is released. So this is, I wanted to give you an overview as to how electron transport chain fits into the overall metabolism. Let's move forward and look at the structure of the electron transport chain as well as various steps which are involved in oxidative phosphorylation. So this is a diagrammatic representation of the mitochondrial membranes. We have the inner mitochondrial membrane, we have the outer mitochondrial membrane, and then we have the mitochondrial matrix. So all the components of electron transport chain is present on the inner membrane of the mitochondria. So we have got cytochrome Q and C as the mobile carrier units, and then we have got complex 1, complex 2, complex 3, complex 4 and ATP synthase. We know that from Krebs cycle, hydrogen ions has been transferred with help of two carrier molecules, NAD and FAD. NAD in form of NADH plus H will transfer its hydrogen ions to complex 1, and from complex 1 it will travel to complex 2, complex 3 and complex 4. From complex 1 to 2 and 2 to 3, mobile carrier unit cytochrome Q helps, and from complex 3 to complex 4, mobile carrier unit cytochrome C helps. And at complex 4, oxygen with two hydrogen and electron forms the water, and this happens in presence of copper, which is present in complex 4. If we see FAD in form of FADH2, the hydrogen has been carried, it bypasses complex 1. And with the help of cytochrome Q, it directly transfers its hydrogen to complex 2. And from there, it takes the same route as the hydrogen ion, which would have come through the first route via NADH plus H. So, what happens when this hydrogen moves through these complexes? Whenever it moves through these complexes, what happens is a hydrogen ions are pumped from the mitochondrial matrix to the space between the two membranes of the mitochondria. This happens at complex 1, this happens at complex 2, 3, and this happens at complex 4. This does not happen at complex 2. So, since FADH2 is bypassing complex 1, hence the amount of energy that will be produced by FADH2 will be less than NADH plus H. It is also said, you can simply think that each complex will produce equivalent to one ATP. So when NAD transfers the hydrogen, because it is moving through three complexes, it will form equivalent to three ATP. And when FADH2 transfers the hydrogen, because it is bypassing complex 1 and it is hydrogen ions will be moved only in complex 3 and 4, it will form 2 ATP. How does it form ATP? Whenever this, so there is a chemoosmotic, presence excess of hydrogen ions in the in between two membranes. What happens is these excess hydrogen ions finds their way back into the mitochondrial matrix by passing through this ATP synthase. And when they pass through this ATP synthase, it powers a reaction where ADP binds with pi and forms the ATP. So this is the chemoosmotic theory of oxidative phosphorylation. In simple words, whenever hydrogen ion is passed from complex to complex, a lot of hydrogen ions are pumped from the mitochondrial matrix to the space between the two membranes of the mitochondria. And these excess of hydrogen ions are find their way back into the mitochondrial matrix by going through this ATP synthase, wherein while passing through this ATP synthase, they will power the conversion of ADP plus pi into ATP. This ATP finally goes into the cytoplasm where it is utilized, and then ADP plus pi can freely move into the mitochondrial matrix. So this is the overview and in-depth understanding of how the electron transport chain functions. Let's look at the more diagrammatic representation of electron transport chain. And first we have the NADH plus H, which will transfer its hydrogen ion to FMN, making it FMNH2 at complex 1. And from complex 1, it will be transferred to cytochrome Q. For complex 2, we know that succinate changes itself to fumarate and giving the hydrogen ion to FAD, making it FADH2. This FADH2 directly gives its hydrogen ion to complex 2, and from complex 2 it goes to cytochrome Q. From cytochrome Q, the hydrogen ions are transferred to complex 3, wherein we see the conversion from the ferric ion to the ferrous ion. Then again from complex 3 it is transferred to complex 4 via cytochrome C. Again at cytochrome C we see the ferric form of iron converting into the ferrous form of iron. Also at cytochrome 4 we see that oxygen, hydrogen and electrons combine together in presence of the copper, which is present in cytochrome 4, making it water. And finally at the last step, ATP synthesis happens. Let's at this point talk about the subtle system in respect to the electron transport chain. We know that out of the two hydrogen carriers, the FAD and NAD, NAD cannot freely enter from the cytoplasm to the mitochondria, as the outer mitochondrial membrane is impermeable to NAD. So what happens? We have got two subtle systems which help in transferring the hydrogen ions of the cytoplasmic NAD to hydrogen ions inside the mitochondria. The first subtle system is called as the oxaloacetate and malate subtle system. So what happens? Oxaloacetate accepts the hydrogen ions from NADH plus H and converts itself to malate. This malate can easily travel the outer mitochondrial membrane and from cytoplasm enter into the mitochondrial matrix. In the mitochondrial matrix, this malate will hand over the hydrogen ions back to NAD, the mitochondrial NAD which is already there in the mitochondrial matrix, and get converted into oxaloacetate. The oxaloacetate cannot directly come out again out of the mitochondrial matrix because the outer mitochondrial membrane is impermeable to oxaloacetate. So it splits itself into alpha ketoglutarate and glutarate. This alpha ketoglutarate and glutarate can easily travel the outer membrane of mitochondria, come back into the cytoplasm where they will combine to form oxaloacetate to carry forward the same subtle system again and again. So this is the first subtle system, and the NADH will now go to the complex one of the electron transport chain and carry forward the oxidative phosphorylation. So once again, repetition, we have the oxaloacetate which will accept the hydrogen ions from NADH plus H and convert itself into malate. The malate now can travel from cytoplasm to mitochondrial matrix. Inside the mitochondrial matrix, the malate will hand over the hydrogen back to NAD and convert itself back to oxaloacetate. Oxaloacetate, because it cannot travel from mitochondrial matrix to the cytoplasm as outer mitochondrial membrane is impermeable to oxaloacetate. It splits itself into alpha ketoglutarate and glutarate. This alpha ketoglutarate and glutarate will travel back to cytoplasm and combine together to form oxaloacetate. Let's look at the second subtle system, which is called as glycerol 3-phosphate DHAP system. In this, what happens, glycerol 3-phosphate accepts the hydrogen ion and gets converted into dihydroxyacetone phosphate, that is DHAP. This DHAP can easily travel from the cytoplasm to mitochondrial matrix, wherein it hands back the hydrogen ions to FAD, converting it into FADS2 and itself back into glycerol 3-phosphate, which is permeable to the outer membrane and can get back transported back to the cytoplasm. Now, in this shuttle, because the hydrogen ions has been handed over to FAD, it will directly go to complex 3 and hence will form less energy. So these are the two shuttle systems which are present to transport the hydrogen ion, which is associated with NAD, from cytoplasm to mitochondrial matrix so that it can help in electron transport chain. Moving forward, let's look at the inhibitors of electron transport chain. This is a diagrammatic representation of the electron transport chain. First, we have inhibitors which will inhibit the transfer of hydrogen ion from complex 1 to cytochrome Q. We have pyrazidine A, amobarbital and rotenone at this step. Then we know that succinate to complex 2 is inhibited by malonate, and from complex 2 to cytochrome C is inhibited by carboxine and TTFN. Complex 3 is inhibited by British antileukocyte, that is BAL, and antimycin A. Complex 4 is inhibited by cyanide, carbon monoxide, hydrogen sulfide, and sodium azide. The ATPase is inhibited by oligomycin, which will inhibit the entry of the hydrogen ion, and atractylocyte, which will inhibit the transporter. Also, we have got an important set of inhibitors of electron transport chain, which essentially uncouples the electron transport chain from the ATP synthesis. So these are called as uncouplers. What they will do is, the electron transport chain will function normally, and however, this will not lead to the ATP synthesis. So what happens, these molecules do is they will create various entry portals so that the hydrogen, excess hydrogen ion between the inner mitochondrial membrane and outer mitochondrial membrane need not necessarily go through the ATP synthase to reach back to the mitochondrial matrix. So we have physiological uncouplers and non-physiological uncouplers. Now, non-physiological uncouplers will be 2,4 dinitrophenol, dicomerol, valinomycin, calcium, and CCCP, which is the most active uncoupler, that is also called as chlorocarbinol cyanide phenylhydrazole. Physiological uncouplers will be excessive thyroxine, thermogenin, long fatty acids in brown fat, increased bilirubin, that is unconjugated, and high dose salicylates. So what will happen when the electron transport chain is uncoupled from ATP synthesis? Obviously, the first will be, there will be no ATP synthesis. Also, because there will be a lot of movement of hydrogen ions from the inter mitochondrial membrane to the mitochondrial matrix, there will be a lot of heat generation, which is the basic function of physiological uncouplers like thermogenin and long fatty acids in brown fat. So always remember this important group of uncouplers, inhibitors of electron transport chain. The brain teaser question for today is, what is the role of physiological uncoupler thermogenin in body? If you know the answer, write in the comment below. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel by clicking here, and once you have subscribed, hit on this bell icon so that you can get a notification whenever we upload a new Medico Apps Masterclass. Check out this next Medico Apps Masterclass, which you may find helpful.